Hello and welcome to another pre-recorded worship service for Clogher and Glenhoy Presbyterian Churches, which has been recorded for Sunday the 18th of April. Now, whether you're a member of either Clogher or Glenhoy or not, it's great that you have been able to log in to this service, and I trust that having done so, you'll be blessed and God will be glorified. Before we begin our service, I'd just like to make a few announcements. This week, whilst I am leading this service, Callum Webster from the Christian Institute is the speaker who will bring God's Word to us, which he kindly pre-recorded for us earlier in the week. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Callum for travelling from Belfast to Clogher to record his message. Next week, God willing, the Reverend Victor Patterson will bring God's Word to us. The midweek Bible study will, God willing, take place on Wednesday the 21st of April via Zoom at 8 p.m, where we will continue with our study of Esther. The login details will, as usual, be on the church websites, as will the relevant study notes if you don't have a booklet. Let us pause for a moment now to refocus our minds. And to do that, let's read from God's Word. In Psalm 118, verses 27 and 28, it says, "The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With bows in hand, join the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Let us praise God now in song with our opening hymn, "The Lord is My Salvation."
The grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from
and when I reach my final day,
We're now going to come before God in prayer. So let us all bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for granting us another day and for blessing us in so many ways. We thank you for this opportunity to draw aside from what normally occupies us on a daily basis, to spend time worshipping you. This is the only right and proper thing to do because of who you are and all that you have done for us. And it is what we were created to do by you. In this world there are many empty cisterns which we drink from in the quest to find meaning and purpose, when in reality we only find such things in you. You breathe life into every single one of us. Not one of us is unknown to you. Nor are we just a face and a name to you. Because as your word teaches us, you know our very thoughts. You know what we fear and what brings us joy. Nothing about us is hidden from you. Therefore, whilst we may appear to others to be upright, decent people who love you wholeheartedly, you see the sinfulness that others can't. You know about the hateful, intolerant, lustful, deceitful, selfish and covetous thoughts that we hide from others with a smile, empty words and so-called good deeds. You know the true motives we have for saying and doing the things that we do. If they are for your glory or purely for our own. We may be able to put on an Oscar-winning performance before others, even those closest to us, but you can't be fooled. And yet despite such things, you offer us salvation that is not based upon our attributes or performance, but purely through faith in Christ and his achievements at Calvary. Through faith in Christ, we are cleansed from all our sin and transformed from sin-stained rebels to your righteously clad children. As your blood-bought children, you love us with an everlasting, unconditional love. And whilst we constantly fail you, you never fail us. Your faithfulness is unfaltering. You never leave us nor forsake us. Unfortunately, Heavenly Father, whilst this is what your word teaches us, we can at times doubt you, especially when we have to deal with circumstances that are hard to fathom and difficult to endure. At such times, O Lord, we can lose sight of who you are and all that you've done for us. So forgive us, we pray, when we have done so. Forgive us for viewing your blessings as things we are entitled to. Forgive us for forgetting that the only thing we deserve from you is your condemnation. Help us now, O Lord, in this time that we have together to catch a fresh and accurate picture of you. Give us eyes to see. Give us ears to hear and minds to understand you better this day, so that in turn we might bring glory to your great and glorious name. Hear us our prayer now, Lord, for it is in our Saviour's name that we pray. Amen. And now we come to our scripture reading. So if you have your Bibles at hand, can I encourage you to open them at our reading, which is taken from 1 Timothy chapter 2, where we'll begin reading at verse 1. So that's 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we will begin reading at verse 1. These are the words of Paul the Apostle to his young protege, Timothy. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Saviour, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. And we had a reading there at verse 4, and We thank God for this reading from His truth. Now, boys and girls, I'd like to spend a few moments speaking to those of you who are watching this. I'm going to ask you a question now, which I know you will all know the answer to. And that question is, do any of you know what a bridge is? Of course you do. A bridge is a structure or a thing that separates or connects two things which are normally separated or divided. For instance, I wonder if you have ever been up to the north coast and crossed over the Carrickarede Rope Bridge. A picture of this should appear on your screens now. This bridge is not far from the Giant's Causeway. Now that small rope bridge connects the island of Carrickarede with the north coast of Northern Ireland. It was originally built to allow salmon fishermen to get onto the island so they could fish for salmon. Without the bridge, they could only get there by boat, which was very dangerous and difficult. Or maybe you have heard about the Forth Rail Bridge. Again, you should see a picture of this on your screens about now. And this crosses the Firth of Forth, which is a big river in Scotland. It connects the south side of it with the north side. This bridge was built to allow trains heading from Edinburgh to Aberdeen to cross the Firth of Forth. Without the bridge, this could not be done, given that trains do not float on water. This bridge is famous for the fact that because it is made of steel, it needs to be painted regularly to stop it rusting and falling apart. And this means there is always a team of people painting parts of it. Now, these are just two examples of bridges, but you will know of many more. Nearly every time you're in the car with your parents, you will either cross over a road bridge or under one. That's because roads have to cross over rivers, ditches or streams, and the bridge connects one side of those with the other. If you travel down the motorway to Belfast, you will see loads of bridges connecting one side of the motorway with the other. And these allow traffic to travel safely over the motorway. So bridges cross over a gap that connect things that would otherwise be divided. In some cases, crossing over those gaps without a bridge is doable, but very difficult or dangerous. And in other cases, it is absolutely impossible. For instance, as I mentioned earlier, trains cannot cross the Firth of Forth without a bridge. And this reminds me, boys and girls, that the Bible teaches us that there is a gap, that because of our sin, there is a huge gap between us and God. That gap is so huge, we cannot cross it ourselves. Nothing we try to do will ever work. No matter how hard we try, it is impossible. But you know, every Easter, which we just celebrated a couple of weeks back, we celebrate a great event, which means we can cross over that gap. The Bible teaches us that Jesus died for our sins. He laid down his life for us and rose again to defeat death. And in doing so, he bridged the gap for us. He bridged the gap between God and us so that if we place our faith and trust in him as our Saviour and Lord, we can have all our sins forgiven and be reconnected to God. So next time you see a bridge, just remember that as it connects two things that were once separate, Jesus Christ bridged the gap between us and God so that we can be reconnected with him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that even though a huge gap exists between us and you because of our sin, we thank you that Jesus Christ, your Son, willingly died in our place to take our sins upon himself, and that he rose again from the dead, so that if we place our faith and trust in him, we can have our sins forgiven and be reconnected with you. Amen. We're now going to pray once again. This time with a prayer of intercession, so let us once again bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we approach your throne of mercy once more, we take this opportunity to remember the work of the Christian Institute before you. We thank you, Lord, for the varied support that they provide churches with and individual believers with across our nation who have found themselves discriminated against or facing prosecution for their faith. We thank you also for the way in which they keep the Christian public informed about important matters such as changes in legislation which contradict your word. Bless those who work for the Christian Institute. Help them, O Lord, to maintain the vital work that they carry out in your name. Lord, on this day we also pray for Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II and the royal family as they mourn the loss of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. Grant them your grace, comfort and strength as they come to terms with his death, we pray. We pray too for our own small province of Northern Ireland, which in recent days and weeks has seen community tensions heightened as a result of civil unrest that is being orchestrated by people with evil intent. We pray, Lord, that calm would soon return to our streets and that these tensions would dissipate. We pray for the police service of Northern Ireland, which, as usual, is caught on the firing line, often accused by all sides of doing wrong. We pray that those police officers who have been injured will be able to make a full recovery and return to duty, and that all police officers will be kept safe, both on and off duty. Finally, Lord, we pray for your church here in the Clogher Valley. Help us, O Lord, who own your name, to live as we ought to, in a way that honours you. Help us, O Lord, to proclaim the message of salvation with words, with our attitude, and with our deeds. We pray, O Lord, for Valerie, Morris, Louise and Mark Breen, as they mourn the loss of Valerie's father, Norman. Grant them your grace, comfort and strength, we pray, as they come to terms with their loss. We also pray, Lord, for all those of our number and those known to us in the local community who are currently unwell. May they know your healing touch, O Lord, and may they, along with their loved ones, know your comfort and reassurance throughout this time. These things we ask, O Lord, in your Son and our Saviour's name. Amen. You're now going to hear from Callum Webster, after which I will announce the final hymn and say the benediction.
Well, good morning. It is good to be with you for your service of worship in this beautiful part of County Tyrone this Lord's Day. Let's turn to the passage we've read from, 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verses 1 through to 4. Here in these verses, the Bible is writing about something it clearly regards as extremely significant. That's why it urges us in verse 1 to consider these matters first of all. And the subject of the Bible's enthusiasm here is the subject of prayer. Prayer for everybody in general, but prayer for kings and those in authority in particular. And since the Bible considers prayer for governing authorities to be such an urgent duty of Christian believers, then we stand to learn important truths by considering this passage in greater detail. So first of all, in verses 1 and 2, we're called to pray for kings and for all who are in high positions or in government authority. And for the early Christians reading this letter, that meant the Roman Emperor, first and foremost, together with all of the provincial governors and officials. And whether those authorities were hostile towards Christians or whether they were benevolent to us, the urgent instruction of the Word of God is that the church offer requests, intercessions, and thanksgiving on their behalf. And the passage goes on to explain why it is so important to pray for those in authority. It's important in verse 2, so that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life in all godliness and holiness. The preserving of peace and stability is a key purpose of civil government. The Bible reminds us of that in Romans chapter 13. Governing authorities are established by God for that purpose. And a good government will make laws that result in a free and a stable society. Christians within those societies will be free to worship God and free to live quiet and peaceful lives according to the Word of God's teaching. So, is the motive to pray for those in authority basically a selfish one? Should Christians be praying for those ruling over us so that we can have an easy time? Well, by no means. In case we miss the ultimate point, it's spelled out in verses 3 and 4 where we read, "For this is good and pleasing in the sight of God our Saviour, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth." So ultimately, the matter of praying for those in authority is a matter of evangelism and the freedom to live a godly life. The Bible here traces a direct line from government authority through to religious liberty down to opportunity for sharing the gospel. Praying for those in authority is a gospel priority. Now, sometimes we in the West, we can entertain romantic ideas that religious persecution would be a wonderful catalyst for gospel outreach. And certainly there have been occasions in history when the blood of the martyrs has been the seed of the church. But those occasions are remarkable precisely because they are the exception. If we were to go today to Christians in North Korea and ask them how easy they find it to share the gospel in their country, I expect they would say they desperately desire a government that would allow them to live quiet and peaceful lives in all godliness and holiness. The full and the widespread proclamation of the gospel, which we know from these verses, pleases God our Saviour, depends largely in human terms on the freedom of individual Christians to live quiet and peaceful lives. Well, the road to religious freedom in our nation over the centuries has taken many twists and turns. But we must recognise that our nation has been greatly blessed by God. Through the influence of Christian believers in past centuries, we have enjoyed a long period of, generally speaking, good government by the Bible's definition. Our Parliament and our law courts have laid down many precious freedoms that remain even to this day. Today in 2021, in the UK, there is no law against sharing the gospel. Today in 2021, churches in this nation still have complete freedom to decide who they will or will not admit into membership. And today in 2021, the law allows street preachers to freely offer the gospel to passers-by, and Bibles can still be placed in many hospital bedsides and in many hotel rooms. And as Christian believers, we should rejoice at this inheritance, we should thank God for it, and we should take advantage of every opportunity it presents to share the good news of sins forgiven and salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. Our brothers and sisters in Christ in other nations do not enjoy such liberties. But our freedoms as Christians are under threat. An ill wind is blowing for gospel freedom in the UK today. If you follow current affairs, if you're signed up to the work of the Christian Institute, if you receive our literature, you will know that there are developments in the public square in this nation which are making it harder for Christians to share the Word of God publicly and harder for Christians to live quiet and peaceful lives according to the teaching of Scripture. And whatever it is right to pray for, it is also right to work for. In Acts chapter 16, the Apostle Paul gives biblical example of taking action to defend gospel freedom. In Acts 16, the magistrates in Philippi, in response to an anti-Christian lobbying campaign, had Paul and Silas arrested, flogged, and thrown into prison without undergoing due legal trial. As you may recall, in the prison cell, Paul and Silas are praying and singing praises to God, and there's an earthquake, and the prison doors break open, and by the grace of God, the Philippian jailer and his whole family are brought to saving faith in Christ. And at the end of Acts chapter 16, it becomes clear to the magistrates that Paul and Silas are Roman citizens, that they should not have been flogged or imprisoned without first undergoing proper trial. And so the magistrates try and release Paul and Silas quietly. They try and let them go discreetly. But the Apostle Paul insists that the magistrates come in person and escort them out of the prison. And this action serves as an embarrassing public acquittal, and it makes it less likely that the magistrates in Philippi will deal heavy-handedly with Christian believers in the future. So let's take on board the lessons, both from the call in 1 Timothy 2 to pray for those in authority and the example of defending gospel freedom in Acts 16. These have laid down a series of principles that are strikingly relevant even today in Northern Ireland in 2021. First of all, religious liberty is very precious because it allows us to openly live out our faith and to publicly proclaim the gospel. Secondly, government authorities in a nation have the power to protect or to restrict gospel freedom. Thirdly, we should therefore urgently pray for those in positions of government authority. And fourthly, our prayers should be accompanied by courageous action which uses the gospel freedoms we already have and which challenges all threats to them. And this morning, those of you who know the Christian Institute work will know that we have been involved with, in recent years, in supporting Christian believers who have faced difficulties because of their Christian stance. Most of us in Northern Ireland are well aware of the case of Asher's Baking Company, a family-run bakery run by Christians who were taken through the courts by the Equality Commission because they politely declined to produce a campaign cake with slogans calling for same-sex marriage. In the Christian Institute's work, we have a legal defence fund, which is there to support Christian believers who face hostility because of their stand for biblical truth. And I want briefly, in closing this morning, to mention two related cases, actually, that we are supporting at the present time. They involve Stirling Free Church in Scotland and a Christian man by the name of Kenneth Ferguson, both of whom are taking legal action against the Robertson Trust, which is the largest independent grant-making trust in Scotland. Kenneth Ferguson was chief executive of that trust, a position he held since 2011. He is also an elder in Stirling Free Church, which paid an annual fee to use trust premises for their Sunday services. And to avoid any perceived conflict of interest, Kenneth Ferguson declared his involvement with the church on the trust's register of interest, and he did not take part in any of the negotiations for the rental of the property. However, the trust chairwoman, Shona McPherson, objected to the rental. According to legal papers, her reason for objection was because Stirling Free Church do not believe in same-sex marriage. In fact, she is said to have become enraged on learning about the agreement and blamed Kenneth Ferguson. The church had its contract torn up and was ordered to leave the building, with the trust claiming that it had a policy of not renting premises for activities that promote religion. But church lawyers have since discovered that no such policy exists. The trust then began disciplinary action against Kenneth Ferguson. He was dismissed from his job in March of last year, and the trust cited vague performance issues. But this was despite him previously having been given glowing appraisals and despite him overseeing substantial growth during his time as chief executive. Mr. Ferguson was highly thought of by trust staff. They were shocked and in some cases tearful at the trust's treatment of him. He had worked under four chairmen, and his relationship with the previous three had been entirely positive. So Mr. Ferguson is challenging the Robertson Trust for unfair dismissal, for religious discrimination, and for religious harassment. The hearing began at an employment tribunal in Glasgow in December and is to be resumed next month. Stirling Free Church is also taking the Trust to court for religious discrimination over the cancellation of their rental agreement, and the church's case is due to be heard in the incoming weeks. Please pray for those involved, a sense of God's peace, especially for the Ferguson family and for the Christian Institute staff and our legal team. It is so important to be able to show that the belief that marriage is between one man and one woman is a belief worthy of respect and protection in our democratic society. As Christians, we're called to pray about such matters, and I would encourage you to pray for Kenneth Ferguson, for Stirling Free Church, for the Christian Institute, and for our legal team. And you can be kept up to date with our work by visiting our website, christian.org.uk. Thank you for allowing me to share with you this morning.
Let us now worship God in our final praise, which is the well-known hymn, "And Can It Be?"
Thank you.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all forevermore. Amen.